Morning. The scripture reading is on page 783 in your pew Bibles. That is the first book of the New Testament, the first chapter in the New Testament, and right at the very beginning. And I thought, given this story, that we could read this together. We're going to read together verses 18 through 25. 783. Now, the birth of Jesus the Messiah took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Her husband Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But just when he had resolved to do this, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet. "Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel," which means God is with us. When Joseph awoke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife and had no marital relations with her until she had borne a son, and they named him Jesus.
Over the last several weeks, we, in both our private and collective lives, have been building towards the coming of the Christmas season. And with that, the expectations that come along with it. I don't know what you picture when you think of Christmas, but I have found, just like most things in life, when you ask someone to describe their idea of Christmas, you're probably going to hear of traditions that sound both strangely familiar and totally new to you. You know, for me, the idea of Christmas has changed over time, but the rituals I have learned to associate with it have hung around and impacted me in ways probably more than I even realize. For example, in my house growing up, we put up our Christmas tree the weekend after Thanksgiving, and my sister and I, when we were younger, this included going to the mountains of North Carolina to pick it out. You know, I was reminded of that as this week, just the other day in Middlebury, I saw someone with a Christmas tree on top of their car, and I was like, man, y'all are late to the party. Like, it was just different, but I knew families that did that growing up. That's what happened. Also, in my house, you had to have a live Christmas tree. There was no artificial substitute that was accepted. The lights, this was in the 90s, and my mom had some Martha Stewart stuff going on, so the lights had to be white in the 90s. That was something that my mom had to have, and it wasn't until my late teen years, when I was almost out of high school, when my mother, I guess deciding she wanted a touch of her own childhood nostalgia, she brought back those big 1970s bulbs, colored bulbs, and that's what we put on our Christmas tree. You know, that caused quite a stir in my household. That was something completely new. Decorations that were on that tree were made up of a collection of different ornaments my sister and I had made either at the house or at school, and they were accompanied beside the ones that we had purchased at Hallmark and other places from fanciful stores. When the tree was finally up, the true trumpet that blew in that signaled the coming of Christmas was the viewing of the first Christmas movie, which for us in our house was National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation. Cousin Eddie and all. As the weeks went by, my family and I in the evenings would pile into the car to go and look at Christmas lights. We drive around the usual neighborhoods, but if we had read in the paper about one particularly over-decorated house, maybe in the next town over, we'd venture out there to see what all the fuss was about. On Christmas morning, I always the one to rise early, would tiptoe into the living room just to see if Santa had come, before finally rushing back in a taxing attempt to raise my slumbering sister, who really could have cared less. She could have slept till noon, it wouldn't have bothered her. She didn't see the need to rush the Christmas morning. Although when I finally did wake her, I would grab her and we would go find our very and confusingly tired parents and gather them around the Christmas tree and we would open presents together. My parents would make breakfast, biscuits and gravy usually, something they continued to do even when my sister and I transitioned into somewhat functioning adults and would return home for the holidays, usually in pajamas, to somehow try and recapture that early childhood feeling ourselves, and maybe even for our parents. Many of these family rituals have influenced my own family's Christmas now. Of course, the blending of Lauren's traditions into mine was expected, and we've even started a few new traditions of our own that we hope maybe to pass down to Violet one day. You know, some of the ones that we read about and we hear other families do, I actually shared one of these through social media. I saw where in the country of Iceland, they do this really beautiful activity where on Christmas Eve night, they gift each other with a book, apparently publishing and reading, and they have more books per capita than anywhere else in the world. Iceland pays a lot of attention to this kind of stuff. So on Christmas Eve, they gift one another books, and then the rest of the evening is spent reading a book in bed, eating chocolate. Now, I don't know if you're a big reader, but I don't know many people who are like, I don't like chocolate. So you could sign me up for that. You know, who doesn't want to lie in bed and eat chocolate and read a book? That's a good way to spend Christmas Eve. And yet, as I've gotten older, and perhaps even a bit wiser, I know the memories I have of Christmas are seen with the very rose-colored and tinted rimmed glasses. I know that not everything was perfect in those moments or on one particular Christmas morning. And as I remember that, I have to be mindful of the concept of expectation. Expectation, especially in the sense of one who gets to define what the perfect Christmas is. That's the question. What is the perfect Christmas for us today? That's the question. That's the question that marketing companies spend millions of dollars on every year. What new toy is going to give your child the perfect Christmas morning? Or which one is going to make your spouse overflow with joy? You know, Lauren and I, we don't have cable right now, but if you have a streaming service like Hulu, they'll still show you advertisements. And I've seen these my whole life, but it's that image or that commercial where a wife or a spouse walks out of the house and they are gifted a new car for Christmas. And it's got that big bow on it. And I remember being a kid thinking, wow, what a cool gift. And as I've gotten older and understand the concept of bills and car payments, I'm like, you just gave them a car payment for Christmas. I don't know if that's a good present or not, or if you paid cash for it, you didn't consult them about buying a several thousand dollar vehicle. Like, I don't know if that's the message that we want to show. But I think about those, and then I think about the other things that influence the way we perceive Christmas. There are all those Hallmark Christmas movies that have been playing really nonstop since right after Halloween. Like Bon Bons or other sweet delicacies, these programs are intended to satisfy one's own guilty pleasure or indulgence of answering the question of what the perfect Christmas should be and should look like. You know, I read a summary that was written to describe these type of movies, and if you haven't seen one, this is how the author describes watching a Hallmark Christmas movie. The plot of every Hallmark movie is about a career woman who is too busy for love and ends up moving to a small town where a handsome local bachelor teaches her about the true spirit of the holidays. And at some point, it starts snowing, and they magically have this wonderful kiss. There's also a dog that needs a home somewhere in there too. Does that sound about right? Or what about the influx of Christmas cards comprised of seemingly perfect family photos? Lauren's family does this every year, and it was something that was new to me. So they send out these nice letters and these photos about their family, and it's wonderful to look at, and we've been looking at a lot of those recently. It's very moving and touching, and getting those letters and pictures, it's reminiscent of an intentionality not really seen in the world today. And yet when I look at these photos, many with smiling children, I think of my own experience with Violet trying to take a simple picture with my phone. And it can be, you know, an act of God to make that happen. And the cosmos need to align. And you know, we tried doing that her first Halloween, and I think we probably took 50, 60 pictures and got three that actually worked. I mean, it just doesn't go as planned. Now, don't get me wrong. I love these kind of pictures, and I think they're depictions that are cheerful and wonderful, but yet maybe they give off that expectation to others and maybe even ourselves that this is how family is supposed to look. This is how we're supposed to be, and yet we know that our families are anything but perfectly put together. This morning, instead of trying to answer the question thrust upon us of what is the perfect Christmas, might we examine whether or not we are even asking the right question during this time of year? For those of us who claim a Christian faith, we tend to focus not so much on a question at Christmas as we do on proclaiming the coming of our Savior. And there is really nothing wrong with that. However, when this proclaiming is being done, are we jumping ahead a little? Are we openly beginning a conversation with others around us with the expectation that they know what we are celebrating and talking about? I myself have been sharing lately the joy of Advent and the focus it gives to my faith, but I wonder if the people even know who I'm sharing that with, do they even know what I'm talking about when I begin describing the Advent wreath and the candles that we light every week? No, I really think I operate under the illusion that when I proclaim my Savior's birth, others know what I mean by that. Instead, maybe the expectation of Christmas shouldn't be that I try and recreate something I deem to be perfect, but instead an invitation to see Christmas and the Christmas story as an invitation into a divinely messy understanding of why I need a Savior in the first place. Matthew's gospel shares with us the story of Jesus' birth. And in that story, Joseph is struggling with a tough situation. It's almost something you would see on a daytime talk show, kind of like Maury Povich. Here is this fella engaged to this young girl, and she tells him she's pregnant, even though they've never known each other in that way. She goes on to tell him that she's carrying a child conceived by the Holy Spirit of God, and they talk about an awkward conversation to have. Joseph hears this news and decides to quietly dismiss Mary as to spare her from public disgrace. The matter appears settled, and I can imagine Joseph, while hurt and bewildered, going to sleep that night with the perception he's done the right thing, or he's going to do the right thing. And then, while during a dream, an angel shows up with a message confirming Mary's claim. Now, on the surface, the angel's message appears to just exonerate Mary. But for the readers of Matthew, the angel's message holds a deeper meaning. The angel, while describing the purpose of the coming child to be a savior to his people, holding the title of Emmanuel, that is, the God with us title, it is also pointing Joseph and the reader to see a very familiar story about a God who comes to save a people. Now, this idea of Emmanuel was not something new. People during this time understood divinity to work in different ways. So saying Emmanuel was actually a common expression. It wasn't a foreign concept to them. And it is why Matthew uses it here. However, this was not your typical Emmanuel. This child was not the result of being a descendant of a random god or from a family of royalty where godhood came attached to a crown. No, this was something new. And in the words of scholar Diane Burgent, she is referring to an Emmanuel beyond their wildest imaginations. This is a call to remembrance from the prophet Isaiah for a people who had been looking for a savior before when they had been taken captive by the Babylonian Empire. There in exile, the people of Israel cried out for someone to come to enter into their lives and save them. Thus, Matthew's gospel account echoes Isaiah's words and tells the reader then and today that the God that heard the people in exile in Babylon still hears the cry of exiled people today. And then God does something about it. Matthew, reaching back through time with words of Isaiah, tells those living in exile that there is a God who has entered into the fray and is coming to save you. And while this message resonated with a specific group of people living in the ancient world, let it also resonate with us this morning. When we say Emmanuel is coming, we must realize that God comes to us because we and the world need a savior. Now, that might be a hard pill to swallow for many, and I can understand why. The average person sitting in church or living in our community might look around and ask, what really do I need saving from? Why does God need to show up? What's the purpose of a Savior? They might reflect on the state of their healthy family, the fact that they have a good job, and that for the most part, they live a relatively joyful life. Yes, absolutely, all that can be true. And yet, while reflecting, can they, and we, admit that this isn't the case for everyone? Can we admit that there are exiles in our society today? We cut on the news and we see refugee camps or refugee prisons where families are separated or are trying to hold together a sense of normalcy as they attempt to live a life under a pitched tent, far away from the home they had to flee for various reasons. Can we admit that when we see a homeless person on the street or on television sleeping in the cold, that we are not looking at the same face of the exile who was imprisoned in Babylon? For them, a Savior is needed. And if we, and I'm talking about those of us who are fortunate enough to have health insurance, those of us who have a house and the 2-car garage and the 2.5 kids and a dog and a picket fence and an income to sustain it all, can we get past the superficial and say that we too are also in some form of exile? When we delve deeper with these type of questions, those we might only utter to ourselves in the late hours of the night, those questions like, why was I created? What is my purpose? What is my life really supposed to be about? And what happens when my life is over? Fellow pastor Daniel Harris says that when that happens, that when we do something like that, when we begin to ask those questions, we come to this, that even then the most contented humanist in us will become restless if they or he or she or we ask these type of questions of ourselves. Because when we do, two things tend to happen. We realize our own state of exile, and we begin to understand that maybe, just maybe, we might need a Savior. We need an Emmanuel. This puts us on a difficult road, leading many of us into risky territory. But that typically happens when we start asking the questions that cause us to change our expectations. When we start asking those probing questions, we find out that we often try, to the best of our ability, to be our own Savior. You know, another one of the Christmas movies that I tend to watch is a Bill Murray movie called Scrooged. He plays Ebenezer Scrooge. Plays the character in a very modern 1980s version of the story, the Christmas Carol. And he says this to his love interest in the movie. He says, "If you want to save someone, save yourself." That didn't work out too well for Bill in the movie, and it doesn't work out too well for us today when we try and attempt to save ourselves or even minister to ourselves. We begin to seek seclusion with saving expectations pointing us elsewhere. And when we fail to meet our own expectations, when that happens, we turn to something to fill that void, be it chemical dependency or maybe a certain relationship or the pursuit of accumulating wealth through unhealthy work addiction or maybe gambling or even for my own self, maybe it's Amazon shopping. I don't know. We can turn to a lot of different things. Instead, perhaps Christmas can be a reminder to us that instead of pursuing expectations that leave us always wanting, we see this time of year as a chance.